I apologize in advance because this video I'm recording on my M1 Max yet again. That's because I'm at my girlfriend's place where I am still in the process of fixing up this garage. Hopefully it'll sound alright. Previously, I made a video on how to run QEMU on an M1 Mac. This video is going to be different because the instructions work for both Apple Silicon and Intel. And we're going to run Mac OS 9 with sound. This requires building a special version of QEMU called QEMU Screamer that has the appropriate sound drivers for Mac OS 9. Before we get started, you need Xcode installed, its command line utilities, and Homebrew. Homebrew, don't mind if I do, if I don't say so myself. Hell yeah. I've written an accompanying article that includes step-by-step instructions on how to do this, and everything moving forward in this video, so you don't have to try and copy everything on the screen. These new instructions have been made possible now that QEMU has an Apple Silicon version, and Homebrew has a lot of Apple Silicon binaries, so we can do all this using the same commands on Intel and Apple Silicon Macs. First, let's get QEMU working. We're going to install QEMU using Homebrew. Homebrew is a package manager for installing open source software on the Mac. Think of it as an app store for mostly command line utilities. First, I'll check to see if I have Homebrew installed by just trying to run Homebrew in my terminal. And of course I do, so let's move forward. I'll type in Homebrew install QEMU. Since I've installed this previously, it'll install quickly, but if it's your first time, it'll take a while as it has many dependencies that are required to run it. QEMU emulates a lot of hardware, and emulating PowerPC Max is just one thing it can do. First, we need to create a hard disk drive image. Anyone familiar with virtualization will understand this concept. It's just a file that contains a virtual hard drive. Once it's done installing, we can create our virtual hard drive. The utility is called QEMU-IMG, and it lets you create virtual disk images. I'll check to see if it's installed, and it is. I'll punch in the command QEMU-create-f, which is format, qcow2, the file extension for QEMU, and I'll give it a name. This can be anything you want, but I'm going to name it myos9.img, and I'll give it a maximum space of 2 GB. Notably, this file will not eat up 2 GB of space, rather it's capped at 2 GB. You can make this whatever you like, but 2 GB is plenty for my needs. You can specify a path to the disk image, but I'm just going to create it to its default location, which is the root of your user directory. Hit enter, and it's created. Now this disk image does not have an operating system on it, so now let's download one. I recently discovered Mac OS 9 Lives version of Mac OS 9.2.2 installer, which is awesome as it's very fast to install, which we'll see in a bit. I'll download it, and it's about 500 megabytes. Again, this is linked in the written version of this guide. Once it's downloaded, it's time to get QEMU running. This is the part that starts to look like a mystery to anyone who hasn't used QEMU before, but I'll try and break it down so it's a little more human. First, we're going to type in QEMU-system-ppc, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's emulating a PowerPC processor. Next, it's time to set up some flags, which are configuration options for terminal applications. There's manuals and guides online for these, and you can look those up. I've done this before, so I know what we need. We'll start by using -L PC-BIOS. I'm not sure if this is necessary, but it works. This is emulating PC BIOS, which is funny as this is going to be a Mac. Next is -boot D. This means we'll boot off the D drive. This is a quirk of QEMU, as the Mac platform never used letters to identify boot drives. The D drive is the CD/DVD drive. Next, we'll use -M, which is the model, and we'll use Mac 99, which is, if I'm not mistaken, a G4. QEMU also comes with the profile to emulate the base G3. Now we'll use a lowercase -m for memory, And we'll give this 512, which is 512 megabytes, which is plenty for Mac OS 9 needs. Finally, it's time to attach our disk images. We will use -hda myos9.img and -cd-rom for the CD-ROM. Be sure to leave a trailing space. Now for the installer disk image path, I find it's easier to drag the disk onto the terminal rather than type the path in. Finally, we hit return, and it'll boot off the CD-ROM image, which automatically starts up with a text window open, which we can ignore, and then the disk utility already open. You'll need to format your hard drive, then within your virtual environment, run the Apple software restore. This will go fast, and this is why I like this installer so much. Now we need to shut it down. You can Control-Alt-G, so you can move your mouse around and just close the window. Now it's time to boot our Mac. We'll use the same command as before, and a terminal shortcut for people who aren't terminal users, type up on your up arrow, and you can cycle through your last commands. I've removed the CD-ROM drive as it's no longer necessary for this, and I'm going to switch my boot volume back to the hard drive, which is the C drive. Mac OS 9 will boot, and we'll have the annoying setup that OSs always want you to do. I'll skip ahead, and here it is. Mac OS is not that interesting without applications, so let's grab the greatest game of all time. And this, without question, is SimAnt. We'll get that from the Macintosh Garden, and they'll have multiple versions, and you'll have to correlate the one you want. I'm going to download the CD-ROM version. To install the game, we'll need to relaunch our virtual machine with the CD-ROM image, which I have for SimAnt. I'll leave my boot drive as the letter C, as I want to boot off the hard drive, and like before, I'll type in -cd-rom with a trailing space, and I'll drag the disk image into the terminal to get the path to the image. I'll install the game onto the hard drive, and I'll launch it, and I can start playing it, and it runs great, except for one very big problem. We don't have sound, and SimAnt has awesome gross sound effects which really make the game. This is because QEMU does not include sound emulations. So we're going to have to do the incredibly geeky thing and download a special version of QEMU called QEMU Screamer and compile it to run on our Mac. For this section, I'm literally going to be following someone else's step-by-step instructions, which again are part of the written guide. I'll move a bit faster here as we're just going to be copying and pasting terminal commands. The first step is to git clone QEMU Screamer. This will take a long time as it's very big. So I highly recommend doing something else, like drinking a wonderful barrel-aged stout. I've skipped ahead as it's installed, and I'm going to go into the QEMU Screamer directory by going cd qemu-screamer. I'm copying and pasting in another big command, which is for installing the required Homebrew utilities. Fortunately, we've already installed a lot of these when we installed QEMU through Homebrew. Skipping ahead yet again, now it's time to do the package config path. Paste that big old command into the terminal and let it do its thing yet again. Now it's time for the final piece, which is to go into the build directory, and then we're going to copy and paste this command, and we're going to build Homebrew Screamer. This will take some time, but it's not super long. It didn't take more than about a minute or two on my M1 Max. Now it's time to run QEMU Screamer with our disk image with our game on it. So let's use the command that we use to normally launch QEMU. First, I'm going to correct the path to my disk image so this application knows where the disk image is. Then next, I'm going to make sure I'm launching the QEMU version that is found in the build folder. And that's done by adding ./ in front of the command. That is because I'm already in the build folder where this application is located. And of course it boots. And this is the moment of truth as this is my first time doing this. So hopefully it's working. And let's launch the application. And hey, I have sound. Right on. QEMU works great for games that do not require 3D hardware on the Mac, as Rave or Glide would take quite a bit to reverse engineer. You can play 3D games that have software rendering modes. QEMU is not limited to gaming by any stretch, but it's probably one of the more popular uses for PowerPC emulation, and it's pretty fast. A quick tip for people downloading software, a lot of times retro software comes in the .toast format, and you can mount these just like a .iso when you're using QEMU. Unreal came this way, the game I'm playing right now, and I'm running at 1024 by 768 only using software rendering. This is actually impressive because, as I recall, there wasn't any Macs that could actually run a game at this resolution in software only. Now, I feel it's important to point out that you do not need to install QEMU via Homebrew in order to do all the things I just did in this video. You can skip straight to building your own version of QEMU Screamer. Of course, you'll still need to create the disk image and then go through the process of installing your OS. My old video still has some great info, and if you're interested in emulating PowerPC Mac OS X, I have instructions in that video how to do it. And my guide will have some of the information in it too. So hopefully you found this video useful and you didn't mind the lower tier production. I promise this is not going to be the new normal. Hey, and thanks for watching. It is snowing in Oregon. This is not common.